There's only one girl in the world for you, and she's probably in Tahiti. Or maybe she's in the Bahamas, where the Caribbean Sea is blue. Weeping in a tropical moonlight night, 'cause nobody told her about you. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world just to find her. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world to find out where they hide her. Why am I hanging around in the rain out here, trying to pick up a girl? Why are my eyes filling up with these lonely tears when there's girls all over the world? Is she lying on a tropical beach somewhere, underneath a tropical sun, pining away in a heat wave there, hoping that I won't be long? I should be lying on that sun-soaked beach with her, caressing her warm brown skin. Then in a year, or maybe not quite, we'll be sharing the same next of kin. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world just to find her. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world to find out where they hide her. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world just to find her. I'd go the whole wide world, I'd go the whole wide world to find out where they hide her.
Ahead of myself, feeling things I've never felt. It's kind of hard for me to explain her personality in everything. Brings me to my knees, oh. She shines me up like gold on my arm. I wanna take it slow, but it's so hard. I love to see her face in daylight. It's more than just our bodies at night. But she's really tempting me, oh. Do you think I'm being foolish if I don't rush in? I'm scared to death that she might be it, that the love is real, that the shoe might fit. She might just be my everything, beyond, beyond space and time in the afterlife. Will she have my kids? Will she be my wife? She might just be my everything and beyond. I wanna bring her round to meet ya. I think you like a candelina. I know that grandma would have loved her like she was her own. She makes me feel at home, oh. Do you think I'm being foolish if I don't rush in? I'm scared to death that she might be it, that the love is real, that the shoe might fit. She might just be my everything, beyond, beyond space and time in the afterlife. Will she have my kids? Will she be my wife? She might just be my everything, beyond. I give up, I'm in love, crying. I'll take. She might just be my thing. Oh me, oh my, can't So do you think I'm being foolish if I don't rush in? I'm scared to death that she might be it, that the love is real, that the shoe might fit. She might just be my everything. Get beyond the eyes, space and time in the afterlife. She had my kids, but she be my wife. She might just be my everything. Get beyond.
Talking like we used to do, it was always me and you, shaping up and shipping out, check me in and check me out. Do you like walking in the rain? When you think of love, do you think of pain? You can tell me what you see, I will choose what I believe. Darling, this body is yours, this body is yours and mine. Well, hold on, my darling, this mess was yours, now your mess is mine. Walking round at 8 a.m. Got 2 hours before my flight. Luck be on my side tonight. You're the reason that I feel so strong, the reason that I'm hanging on. You know you gave me all the time. Well, did I give? This body is yours, this body is yours and mine. Well, hold on, my darling, this mess was yours, now your mess is mine.
Grab a seat, grab a seat. Let's have some fun. Is the mic, I feel like it's really staticky. I don't know if it's, does it sound staticky?
I
yeah.
I think it's moving when you walk.
So.
Oh, let's grab another one.
Do you want me, yeah, is it just the? Test, 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 test.
And then is that one? Is it? Yeah.
It was Steve. It's always Steve. Yeah. You can't trust Steve for nothing, man. That's how he makes all his money. He just goes through church parking lots, cleans them out. Yeah. We know they're paying 10%. They can spend more on me. You're horrible. You're horrible. Have you heard the comedian Anthony Jeselnik? We're listening all the way home. He's absolutely inappropriate, like you. Yeah. Oh, let's go to Wise Guys. Yeah, no, I love Wise Guys in Salt Lake. I love that. Or we could just do like a binge all night long with pizza at home, which would be hysterical as well. That'd be, I'm all for getting cozies. Let's just stay home and laugh out loud. Yeah, well, that's what we'll do. We'll have a welcome home party. Actually, I don't know where we're going to live. We're still homeless. So whenever we get home, whatever that new home is, I have no idea. You might, yeah, but I want to rent. I don't want to waste your time with rental. And it's only in Saratoga. So right now there's like four houses to choose from. Actually, there's two to choose from. And so it's like, yeah, I mean, we're going to, if I could convince her to get an RV, I would just live in an RV. But yeah, no, you can't. You can't. That's true. That's true. Jill, I see her in our RV all the time, but I didn't know she's actually going to sell it all. Yeah. Good for her. Good for her. All right. Shay, Shay. All right. We all ready to play?
Yeah.
1936, Christian Tolstrup had a department store and had 1,000 coats right before the Great Depression hit. So he has this beautiful facility. He's on the corner. He's got his name on the building, but it's the Great Depression. So he can't sell anything. You think about 2008, you think about 1999, and you know we're at that crest of going into a new recession slash potential depression. And the thing about this story that blows my mind is his mindset. You've got 1,000 coats. You've got a department store, you got no foot traffic, no one's coming out, what do you do? He hangs all 1,000 coats on his building, sells them in 48 hours. City came to shut him down because it was a serious fire hazard, but didn't matter, he sold 1,000 coats in 48 hours. And that's how it comes to just being able to think differently. Your mindset's what wins. So I love what Henry Ford said, whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're right. We all do that. We all have these limiting beliefs. We all have these structures in our minds. We all have these, I want to say stories, but really what I want to say is lies. We have these lies that we tell ourselves over and over and over again. The more we tell ourselves, the harder it is to change that mindset. Harvard did a fascinating study. They went to an elementary school, and they created a test to test elementary school students to see at what level they were on the scale of intelligence and genius. So they did this test, and they found that about 20% of the students identified as geniuses. Then they went back 1 year later. They told the teachers, like, these 20% of your class, they are geniuses. They are amazing. So they went back 1 year later. Here was the results. They increased their IQs by 15 points, which on the scale is enormous. Kids were more curious, happier, and better adjusted. Absolutely best part, test was fake. Test was totally fake. It didn't exist. They were doing that just to see what the teachers would do differently if you identified 20% as geniuses. And here's what happened. They ended up collaborating more with the kids who identified as smart. So they gave them more attention. They listened more. They paid more attention. And they gave more feedback. That's what changed them and changed these kids. It wasn't anything to do with the test or actually being smart. But what that hits with me is, are we pre-sorting our opportunities? With our mindset, are we already labeling like these teachers did, this is good, this is bad, this is a waste of time. They are smart, they are average, they are stupid. In our life, as we go through, we start to label everything. And if you go back thousands and thousands of years, we had to do that for survival. People living on the plains, people living out and about, they were worried about animals coming in, destroying their lives. They had to label safety. But in a world we live in now, we're doing it subconsciously. How many of you guys here have an opportunity and instantly label it before you've even researched it? right? We all do that. We still do that. I love this quote by Sarah Blakely. It's if you don't know her, she invented Spanx. Brilliant product. My dad encouraged us to fail. Growing up, he would ask us what we failed at that week. If we didn't have something, he would be disappointed. It changed my mindset at an early age that failure is not the outcome. Failure is not trying. Don't be afraid to fail. So I didn't have a parent that way. I mean, I love my mom and dad, but I didn't have a parent who wanted me to fail. And as I read this quote years ago, I went to our kids and I started asking them, what risk have you taken? Who did you introduce yourself to? Did you go out for something? Did you try something? Because if you don't, well, what are we becoming? So when you look at your beliefs, like where do your beliefs actually come from? Of course, they come from your environment. They come from the situations, you know, nurture, nature, how you were raised. But when it comes to your drive, it goes even deeper. Does anyone here not know their drive? Because I think we could actually skip this part because I think every one of you guys know your drive, right? All right, I'll do this. For those of you playing at home, thank you very much for coming. Take a screenshot of this right now because we're going to kind of bypass this because everyone here knows their drive, right? I don't want to bypass if we don't, but if we know it, great. Okay, so if you're at home playing, thank you. Take a screenshot, take your phone out, take a picture of this. So when your drive, you've identified your drive, it comes to where your beliefs are. So if you're a director, where's my directors in the room? Perfect, a good chunk of us. So here's your beliefs, and tell me if you agree or don't agree. You have a belief that life is meant to be experienced and lived to the fullest. Creativity is the key to success, and purpose and freedom are essential. So for you directors, is that accurate? Right on. For my relators, where's my relators? Yep, two. Relationships are the foundation of a fulfilling life. Service to others is key to happiness. Authentic communication is vital for healthy relationships. Do you agree? Susan's like, oh yeah. Intellectuals. Do we have any intellectuals? Because Christian's not here. Christian's always my only intellectual. I love it. He's not here the one time. But for those that are playing at home, if you are an intellectual, knowledge is power, organization is key to success, and the present moment is always precious. Validators, any validators? We've got validators, boom, boom, boom. Validation is crucial for self-confidence. Trust is essential for a healthy relationship, and admiration is a motivation for success. Agreed? Beautiful. Our executives, where's our executives? I'm a director executive, so yep, great. Winning is everything. Control is essential for success, and results matter more than almost anything else, right? Yeah, like, amen, right there, for sure. So, because of our drive, because of our beliefs, we judge the world. Think of it like glasses, if you will. If you're a director, you put on the glasses of lifestyle. Relator, you put on the glasses of community. Intellectuals are looking for a system. Validators are looking for admiration. And executives are looking for proof. So when things come up, when things hit us, it's always going to hit your drive, your filter, your association to how you see the world. One of my favorite stories that illustrates this is about Ferruccio. Ferruccio was born into a family of farmers. He wanted to be more than a farmer, but his dad and his dad's dad and his dad's dad and his dad's dad and families were all farmers. During World War II, he was shipped off to fight in the war and got captured. During that time of being captured, the enemy made him work on their motorcade to keep it running. When he came home, he thought, you know what? There's all these old surplus machines. Maybe I can use these and start selling them to other farmers. And he started to have a little bit of success. He ended up creating his own by 1949, built his own tractor under his own brand, his own name, and he started having a lot of success with it. Then he thought, you know what? Tractors are no different than air conditioners and heating, and thought, you know what? Let's build a huge factory. Now, this is when his success really took off. Now, he is a director, so he's all about lifestyle. So what does he do? He buys himself some exotic cars. He's having fun. He's made a little bit of money. But what he realized is, the clutches in the Ferraris kept slipping. So being a mechanic by trade, he pulls apart the engine, the transmission, and realize it's the exact same clutch he's putting in his tractors for $10 and Ferrari's charging $1,100. It's like, this is wrong. Like, I'm going to put my foot down. This is wrong. So he goes to corner Enzo Ferrari and just said, hey, you know what? This isn't right. You're charging me too much. These are the same. And in fact, when I put my tractor clutch in, it works way better than your Ferrari clutch. And Ferrari said what I think is just insane. He said, you're a farmer. You shouldn't complain driving my cars because they are the best cars in the world. How many more Ferraris do you think he bought after that? Zero. Zero. Ferruccio is an executive. He's all about proof. He's like, I'm the best, all about winning control, being external. I don't need you. You're just a farmer. So Enzo sees Ferruccio through his view, his mindset as a executive. Ferruccio is a director saying, well, shoot, I'll just go make my own car. Ferruccio Lamborghini made tractors. Then he thought, if I can make tractors, I sure as heck can make cars. And he built what I consider some of the most beautiful vehicles in the world. What's funny about this story is, had Ferrari just been nice, had he just taken a little bit of time, just been kind, he would not have his world's greatest competitor. He would have had the world's greatest consumer customer. Would have bought collections of Ferrari, but he didn't. So when you get stuck in your mindset, what does it feel like? And this is, I want to make it very interactive. I want to make it just fun to play here. Open up the kind of floor, if you will. When you get like stuck in your mindset, what, everyone has a different process because of the different filters. Where do you guys get stuck? What things do you get stuck on? I was like, you always do that. It always throws me off. I see you raise your hand. I'm like, ah, not yet, not yet. You did that like six times last week. And I kept thinking, oh, no, oh, no. But now I'm going to call you anyways. All right, give it to me. Yep. Yep. Okay. So for those of you listening at home, you didn't hear that. When he's working, he's got an idea, and then he gets stuck. And when he gets stuck, it feels like a dark place. Would you guys all agree we all go through that regardless of your drive? You've got an idea. You're going down a road, and you hit a roadblock. You hit a barrier, and you're stuck, and it feels like that. And we all agree, right? So what do you usually do? What are some things that you do to try to break through it? And then I'm going to ask all of you guys, what are your go-to moments that you use to break free? Okay. Love it. So winging it, research. What's your drive? Director, okay. This side of the room. What do you guys do? Like when you get stuck, you hit that wall, what's the first go-to in your head or where do you go? Talk it out. And what is your drive? The validator. Okay, so validators and relators are great at communication with other people. So if other relators in the room, do you guys talk it out? You're a relator, right? When you get stuck, do you talk it out? Yep. Yes. Yep. Love that. Yeah. Yep. I like that. So once again, those of you listening at home, so if you get stuck, seek mentorship. What was the first one you said? Or just doing it. Like just don't even think about it. Sometimes just pushing through. We overthink it. Yeah. Yeah. It's one of five. It doesn't have to be complicated. Yeah. Just guessing you got 20%. So this year I did a lot of research on, like every year I get themes in my head and I just go down these rabbit holes. And one of the rabbit holes I've really gone down, especially in the last 3 months, is clarity and conviction. So if you have clarity, that's the mindset element. You have clarity of what you're trying to achieve, whatever it is. That encourages the conviction, the energy, the desire to take a step, and that's when we take massive action. So if you look at the clarity for directors, here's how you get clarity. So if you're stuck, this is a solution with your mindset. Engage in creative activities. So I know a lot of you have been in my house. On the bar in our kitchen, we have toys, just tons and tons and tons of toys. That's to help me engage in creative activities. Seeking new experiences. We're going to Europe for the summer because I want to build my business. So by going to Europe makes me stretch myself mentally and emotionally, connecting with others. So this is, you would think, oh, that's got to be for relators. No, I actually took the entire Drive book, dropped it into ChatGPT, and asked, how do you help a director? And it said, connect with others. Now, I've been a director my entire life. I thought, well, that's not true. But it is, because others are creative. Others are free and independent. Others can solve problems. So it's not that others make me feel important. Others help me get my drive met. So if you're a relator looking for clarity, set boundaries. Number one for you guys, because you're the givers. You're the heart. You're the one who always takes care of other people. If you're trying to get clarity, put the brakes on. It's the whole put the oxygen mask on yourself first so you can help other people. So feed yourself first. Reach out to your community. Reflect on your values and your motivations, like what moves you. Intellectuals, when you're trying to increase your mindset and set and get clarity, this is a good one, seeking advice from others. Because usually intellectuals think they're the smartest person in the room. So having to humble yourself or being internal enough to go seek advice from others is a great way to find a new mindset. Prioritizing based on your values, break the problem down into small, bite-sized steps. For our validators, reflect on your strengths. You're so good. Validators are phenomenal at being the ultimate cheerleader, lifting and supporting other people. So reflect on your own strength. Seek advice from a trusted source and consider the impact you've already had on others. So validating who you are, supporting who you are, so you have the energy and strength. Our executives focus on the big picture because usually executives hate the small detail. So if you focus on the big picture, your mind's like, okay, I can outthink this problem. It's like having a dream bigger than your fear. Research and gather proof because that's what you secretly desire, and then just take massive action. Just bulldoze through it, answer it, go for it, and just keep hitting it. The impossible is rarely impossible. I love games. I love Rubik's Cubes. And with Rubik's Cubes, there's actually 43 quintillion options to it to solve it. And if you want to be really precise, that's the number. I can't say it out loud, but that's the actual number of combinations to solve a Rubik's Cube. But there's 7 algorithms. So when my niece was born, this was, gosh, 23 years ago, I went and bought a Rubik's Cube because I knew to be in the hospital and I don't do good being bored. So I have a Rubik's Cube and play with it. I ended up keeping that same Rubik's Cube for 10 years. And then one day I thought, I've never solved this thing. You know, I always get the top, no problem, but I've never solved it. So I go onto YouTube and type in how to solve a Rubik's Cube. There's 2 videos and you can solve it in under 2 minutes on your first time. It's 7 simple algorithms. You can just watch YouTube and go left, right, up, down, left, right, center, left, down, up, right, left, right. And in less than 2 minutes, it solves it. I love the analogy of Rubik's Cubes because it's the same as human beings. There's these quintillions of options, but there's really like 7 things that make you feel important. There's very small amounts of things that change everything. So I'm going to give you 5 solutions to increase your mindset, to change it, to just really power yourself. Truth versus belief. This is my favorite one. It's challenging everything you think you already know. So years and years ago, I was exhausted. I was frustrated from coaching. And I was turning to my wife. I said, I'm burned out. I'm done. I'm going to quit. And she goes, is that the truth or is that just a belief? And I never heard that phrase before. I thought, well, let me go research that. So I spent months researching the concept of truth and belief. Here's what I found out. Truth is universal in every continent, no matter what continent you're on. If I walked out of a plane in Japan, a button-down shirt with long sleeves, they have a word for that, correct? They have a word. We call it long sleeve shirt, dress shirt. They have a word. I can go to Africa, anywhere that has the same clothing, they have a word. That's a fact. So that's truth. The belief is is it fashionable? The belief is, do I look good in it? The belief is, did I pay too much or too little? The belief is, and it's all the lies we tell ourselves. If you break down how many actual truths there are in your life, this isn't a real number, but in my head, there's like 27. Your height, your weight, your name, your address, like very factual, provable things. Everything else is a belief. Another great story that illustrates this is a battleship was coming off the coast of Maine and saw an oncoming light. It signaled the light, move 10 degrees to the east. Light came back, no, you move 10 degrees to the west. Now the captain of the battleship's feeling pretty like confident. It's like, I'm a captain, move 10 degrees to the east. Light came back, I'm a third class seaman, move 10 degrees to the west. Now he's feeling totally justified because he's a captain against a third class seaman. I'm a battleship, move 10 degrees to the east. Light comes back, I'm a lighthouse, move 10 degrees to the west. We go through life as battleships, but there are those truths, those imminent, just like spot on facts. So when you get stuck with your mindset, ask yourself, is this a truth or is this a belief? And people say, well, it's my truth. There is no such thing as somebody's truth. It is 100% their belief. Truth is universal. Favorite scripture on that? Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. When we liberate ourselves, we can do anything. And that comes down to what I call a mind shift, where you literally shift your mind like that captain. He's like, or like the captain of the battleship. He's like, wait a minute. I don't want to hit the rocks. I will follow the truth of the lighthouse who's purposely trying to get me to safe harbor, and I'll move 10 degrees to the east or west. So George Clooney, and he was starting out in his acting career, was getting turned down audition after audition. And if you've ever read any biographies or really studied actors or musicians, it's a hard thing to do, to literally put yourself out there. Imagine applying for a job every day and then just say no, no, no. He had this epiphany, a truth. And this truth changed his entire projection of his life and the company he built. Truth was this. They cannot make a movie without actors. He realized, wait a minute, I don't need them, they need me. That confidence, that knowledge instantly built him off. He walked in differently. That's how he got the show of ER. And that's how he got Ocean's 11, 12, and 13. He realized that people are not the solutions to your problems. You are the solution to their problems. That little bit right there changed everything for him. Next one to change your mindset, kill comparison. I love the phrase, measure what matters. If you can't quantify it, scratch it, sniff it, measure it, it doesn't matter. It's one of those things where it's just a belief at that point. When it comes down to comparison, we know that comparison is the thief of joy. We know that comparison kills confidence, it kills emotions, it kills desires, because all I'm saying is I'm not good enough, and therefore I'm comparing myself to someone else. Dave Mustaine was in a rock and roll band, and he was struggling with drugs and alcohol, and he had a rough time, and he got so bad, it was back east, that his band members kicked him off the bus, like abandoned him at a gas station, said, you're on your own, get your own way home, you're out of the band. On the way home, he had this confirmation, he's like, I'm going to be the biggest rock star on the planet. I'm going to change, I'm going to prove to these guys. And he ended up owning and creating Megadeth. Megadeth sold 38 million albums. You know, if you do more than 1 million, that's called a platinum album. 38 million is huge by any stretch. I mean, this puts him in the top 50 time artists of all time. But along that journey, he kept comparing to his previous bandmates. He kept following them. He kept showing up at their concerts, seeing what they were doing, reading about them in the magazines. Problem is, his bandmates were Metallica. And they sold 125 million. So his entire time, he was having this enormous success. He never even noticed because he kept comparing himself. Imagine that, robbing yourself of success simply by comparing. These guys are doing their own thing. They don't even know he's comparing. That's the sad part. When we compare, it's like drinking poison, hoping it hurts somebody else. All it does is hurt us. Next one, play more. The opposite of play is not work, it is depression. I'm gonna say that again. The opposite of play is not work, it is depression. You have to have hobbies. You have to play. You have to have fun. You have to get out there. Let's be honest. Life can be very stark, can be very hard, can be very challenging. Susan, at church, you had your car broken into and everything taken on Mother's Day, right? Like, that's horrible. Like, that's a real thing, right? I don't want to say I live in this fairy tale world, like everything's fine. It's not. But I will tell you this, playing will pull you out faster than almost anything. Here's why. I'm not talking about competitive playing. I'm talking about playing. If you have a small child or you've been around small children, they can be crying, they can be fighting. You give them a new Hot Wheel, a Barbie, or a new toy, instantly like, okay, great, we're going to play now. And they forget all the heartache. What makes us think we're any different at age 20, 30, 40, 50, 60? We're not any different. We did that for the first 20 years of our life. Why does that change? We forget, and that's it. As adults, we quit. I know you guys are addicts to Lego, like I am. So when you have a bad day and you sit down, I have to tell you about their house. So they have this table, and they went to their family and said, everyone pick your own chair, like customized chair. If you want a gaming chair, you want a leather chair, whatever you want. And they put it around the table, and that is like their identity. And then they play. They play all the time. How many of those helpful discussions with your children came while you were playing with them? And those are the ones that stick. Yep. There's always a puzzle. Every picture I see, it's always this. Something's being made. Some toy, some fun is being created. And if not, you're cooking. She cooks like amazing stuff for the world. So is that play for you? Like when you cook, is it play? Okay, that's an important thing to notice. There are things that you love to do. There are things that are fun, but when it turns to work, you've got to find a new thing. So I was having this discussion with my son Hunter this morning where he loves to create during his work. This last week, he didn't have as much work, and he said, it's the most depressed I've been in a long time. And he was trying, like we all do, we whack at the branches, we never go to the root. I asked him, I said, when's the last time you played? Couldn't remember. I said, okay, so what happened is you play while you work, you aren't working this week. So you have to replace that. It's the law of exchange. You cannot take something away from somebody without replacing it with the same or equal value. When you're out hiking and camping, is that play to you? Yeah. Even though it's work, you get paid for it, but it's still play for you. Yeah, so it doesn't matter if you're being compensated. It's the concept of play. Does it feel like play? And if it doesn't, be her. Just be her. Next one, do the impossible. I have this weird addiction to hard things, and I don't know where it came from. She laughs at me all the time. If it's painful or hard, for some reason, I want to do it. Not for anybody else, just for myself. I just want to see if I can do it. So when I learned and studied mindset, when you do really hard things, and I mean not for anybody else, only for you, there is an endorphin that gets released, serotonin that gets released, even if you don't accomplish it, even if you don't pull it off, the fact that you tried. And I love what Tim Ferriss, who wrote The 4-Hour Workweek, said, to do the impossible, you need to ignore the popular. That to me really solidifies is what it means to do the impossible. You don't have to accomplish the possible. You have to try the impossible. Because what that does is it gives you permission to walk away from the popular. The popular is always the committee approved. So when you're going to do the impossible, you're walking away from the group just to have your own journey, to do a walkabout. Prime your brain, challenge everything, music, mantras. There's a phrase we have in our family, and we learned it from a friend of ours who, the CEO was of Bain Capital. And we learned through her that Bain Capital, they're the ones who invested in Domino's, Gymboree, Guitar Center. Whenever they have a new business, they take all the, all the numbers, all the facts, they put it into a business plan, they put it on the conference room table, they bring in all the vice presidents and presidents of all the divisions, and they say, okay, challenge it for the sole purpose of making it better. There's no ego. There's like, oh, Tim did this wrong and John did that wrong and Susie did this wrong. No, it's like this is a blank slate. There's no identity to this. There's no ego attached. What do we have to do to make it better? So in our family, we'll have that. And we say the phrase, this is it right here. Challenge everything. Let's challenge it. Let's challenge it. In our marriage, let's challenge it. What are we missing? no ego again, no identity. When you do that, what happens to your brain is all of a sudden, your brain processes information at 256 miles per hour. It's a Bugatti Veyron flat out in your brain. Synapses are snapping, flying through your brain. When you give it permission, brain, you have the right to think any way you want today. I have a problem in front of me. I want you to challenge it and find a better solution. All of a sudden, your brain's like, oh, let's play. This is going to be fun. Let's change it. But if you attack it as, well, I'm trying to protect and defend this, and I don't want anyone to know this, and I'm going to, then you lose. So learn to challenge everything. There's nothing you shouldn't have the ability to challenge. Anything and everything. Keeping this in mind, you have a 100% track record of overcoming hard days. No matter how bad your day has been, and we've all had horrific days in our lives, you have a 100% track record. 100%. You're here today, you have 100%. Tough times don't last, tough people do. So before we go into the next section where we're going to sales, because last week I asked, what do you guys want to know? How to overcome challenges, sales, mindset. Before we go into the sales side of things, what do you want to know about your drive and mindset? Dude, you did it again. I saw it, man. And I love it. I love it, but now I know it, so I'm calling it out. No, you don't, because now I know what you're telling. Like, if I was ever playing poker and you were thinking, like, oh, I'm taking them down. Yes. Okay, I'll throw one out because I am a director. Let me see if this is a problem. Do you ever get stuck in the dream? Meaning, and see for my other director's room, do you ever feel like you think visionary? Directors are very visionary. They want to accomplish and change the world. They're very passion-driven. They're very purpose-driven. That you get lost in, how am I going to do it all before I die? Oh, that's good. For those of you listening at home, this is a good one. I push hard towards something, I work hard towards something, but every time I get close to it, I feel it goes further away. Is that because you're changing the goalpost? Because that happens to a lot of us. Yeah. Because as a director, you're all about creativity, so you keep thinking new ideas. Like if you choose, I'm just using analogy, I'm going to walk to Oregon. On the way of walking to Oregon, like, hey, San Francisco's on the left, let's go over here. And oh, the ocean, let's learn to surf. And so directors on the way, our mindset says, I want to do it all. I want to be creative. I want to experience life. I want to do it all. And so sometimes it does feel like it doesn't connect us to our destination. Yes. I know. Oh, yes. Staying, okay, that's a good universe one. How many of us here have a problem with staying focused? Why do you think you do? There's not a right or wrong answer, I'm just curious. Why do you think you have a problem staying focused? Yes. 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 Okay. Yes. Yes and yes. Okay. This is why I researched this year. Is when you have conviction, you have focus. There's a phenomenal book, and I apologize in advance for the title of it. There is a phenomenal book called The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F by Mark Manson. If you go on to Google, it has 165,000 five stars. It's absolutely insane how many five stars. I'll tell you up front, if you choose to read it, the first chapter, and I'm not exaggerating, probably says the F word 300 times. Not exaggerating. At the end, there's like one sentence. He says, if it was hard for you to read this chapter, that's the problem. If four letters in this combination
hold you back. That's the issue. And then the rest of the book, he maybe says it three times. But that first chapter is this total shock. But what he says in there, he goes back to exactly what you're talking about. He said, we care too much about too many things. He said, choose a handful of things to care about. Don't care about all of it. Pick a handful. And to me, that's where clarity comes in. If you are super, super clear on what you want, there are no distractions. The problem is we live in a society now where the distractions reward us with dopamine. Oh, I should go do this. Oh, I should go do this. What about this? What about this? So I'm getting that fix of, oh, yeah, I want to do this. I want to do this. When reality is, if you are hardcore clear on what you want, it's not hard. Richard Branson. Richard Branson, who owns Virgin Atlantic, Virgin Records, Virgin Cola, and the UK. Years and years ago, I heard him tell the story where he got very clear on what he wanted. He had three objectives for his life and his business, and it was only those three. A company called him up, wanted to do some consulting with them, offered him a ton of money, and the secretary, his gatekeeper, said, no, not interested. Like six times this person called up saying, hey, no, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll fly out, I'll send a jet. Offered the world. On the seventh call, he finally said, how do I get him? Like, just tell me the secret, because obviously he's doing other things with other people. I said, well, thank you for finally asking. Here's the three things he's working on, and it's only these three things. If you can get whatever you want him to do to tie to these three things, he'll show up. So, okay, great, I'll call you back. Took a couple days, thought about it, called back. Richard shows up. Because if you're clear, you don't need to worry about anything else. It's just there. And what's cool is, when you are clear, conviction's there. Like, you're hungry for it. You don't lose sleep over it. You're just like, you're all in. Beautiful questions. Any other thoughts, questions on mindset? Yeah.
So I had a client that was wanting to do some work and stuff, and it involved getting a lot of other people involved in it and everything else. I was like, you know what? No. That's not the path I want to go. What I'm focused on and my goal is where I'm most profitable, and that's where I'm generating.
Yep.
I sent him a text and stuff, and I'm like, sorry. Other
guys
that are focused in that area. He called me. I'm focused on this area. Those few projects. Like even my uncle today, I talked to him. He's like, I need to come build an addition to the garage. I'm like, no.
Yep. If any of you feel exhausted or it's hard for you to manage everything, I heard the coolest quote. No is a complete sentence. No is a complete sentence. Nope. Well, thank you. There's nothing else you have to say after that. If you don't want to do something, no. That's it. There's no discussion. Years ago, 20 plus years ago, when I got started as a speaker, I remember... you're trying to get on stages, you're trying to get business, and everyone wants to know, well, what are you good at? And so you lie, you make it up. Well, I can talk about this and this and this because you've read a bunch of books and you think you're good at it. Every time I see someone who does that, I instantly know they have no priority in their life. Because I do two things and two things only, sales and mindset. That's it. I don't coach on anything else. I have mastered those two. If you want goal setting and you want time management, I've read the books, I understand them, but I'm not going to spend my time on it because that's not my superpower. So my superpower is mindset and sales. So when you look at your life, get really clear on your business. Get really clear on what you're focused on and only do those things. Say no to everything else. What's cool is when you start saying no, one, you feel liberated and you feel validated because you took care of yourself. But more importantly, your schedule frees up. I have an enormous amount of free time to create the way I want to create because I'm not constantly saying yes to everybody else. Steve reached out to me and said, hey, man, let's go to dinner before you leave to Europe. I'm like, I love you. I would do it in a heartbeat. No. Can't go. Like, I have 10 days to pack, and I'm nowhere near it. But no. He knows, I love you, right? Yeah. So we'll have dinner when I get back, right? when you tell people no, if they get mad at you, great. You don't want to spend time with them. Like that's the best filter. If you want to know whether or not you want to spend time with someone, if you say no and they act irrationally towards you, I'm glad I said no early in this relationship. Yeah, it works that way. Yes, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. I'm not going to pack tonight. Come home with me. That's fine. Yeah. What other things do you, this is what's cool. Today we have a very small intimate group and I love it. I have just, you guys will always get kicked out of this. So I have 153 slides I prepared tonight. We covered 69. So there's another 100 there. I don't care what we cover. This is my last live event before, did I lose control? This is my last live event until September. I want this to be all about you guys and what you want. What is the number one thing you guys really feel you need right now? We can go into sales if you want, but I just want to know what you feel you want, and that would be the most value to you. Sure, sure. I love it. Love it, love it, love it. And believe it or not, I guarantee you other people in this room have that same question because this question does come up every event I have ever done. Literally every single time. So you're a director and a validator, correct? Okay. So you always have to go back to the question, what makes you feel important, not what's important to you. So work and family can be important to you. Work and family may not make you feel important. So if you look at these keywords, these seven words that make you feel important, which card has more words on it that makes you feel important? And it doesn't mean you lose anything, doesn't mean you have to give up anything. What one has the most words that make you feel important? Okay, which one, this is great though, this is everyone deals with this. Which one could you not live without? Okay, beautiful. So this is for everyone playing at home, same thing. I always ask them, which one can you not live without? That's what's called your primary drive. So this is your car, this is what you're shooting for, this is your objective in life, is freedom, lifestyle. How you do it is through validation. So trusting yourself, recognizing your strength, your ability. You took a huge risk. You moved down to Southern Utah on your own type thing. That's because you relied on this. This is the gas that fuels this. Yes. Beautiful. Love the question. What are the questions we have? And I'll bounce around. I got 1,000 PowerPoint slides, so I'll go anywhere you guys want to go. This is my favorite part, is just the Q&A part. Yes. You totally. Let's talk about procrastination because people always ask that as well. You do not procrastinate. Nobody procrastinates. All you're doing is shifting your energy to protecting yourself. That's why we procrastinate. So the reason why, in theory, we procrastinate is we're trying to protect ourselves. So somebody or some external force has put on you that you have a deadline, you need to do something. So let's go for a real life example. What's something you procrastinate on usually? Okay. Sure. Oh, this is gonna be fun. Okay, what's your drive? Okay, so relator, director. So this is what you want. You want the community and the relationships. How you go about it is through director. Now I'm gonna role play with you. Correct me if I'm wrong, because this is your experience, not mine. So being creative and free and independent. What happens is if you aren't feeling free and creative, you will procrastinate. 100%. 100, like instantly, right? There's 2 years worth of therapy right there for you, okay? And we all do it. This is the gas. If the gas is contaminated, meaning it's external, we look to other people, places, or things. Anytime we have external motivation, the gas is contaminated. Therefore, it doesn't fuel. So what we do is everything else but that thing. And this is why universal logic doesn't exist. What's logical to you is not logical to me. We have different drives. So I'm going to show up sometimes where you're not, and vice versa. I only procrastinate when I'm not clear and not convicted. If I have clarity and conviction, that means I'm internally driven. I don't procrastinate anything, ever. But I procrastinate everything. There's some things I told my son that if I didn't have it done by Sunday, I'd pay him $250 because I haven't done it in 3 years. I thought, okay, by Sunday, I'll have it done. I promise by Sunday. And if not, here's the penalty. It's $250. So now what I've done is I've turned it into a game. I've gamified this problem. And now it's fun for me as a director and as an executive to win and control. I chose the deadline. I chose the penalty. He didn't. So now I feel I'm in control. I'm going to provide. I'm going to solve my problem. I'll feel secure by Sunday night, and I'll reach my goal. But for 3 years, I haven't done it until you commit to it. So it comes to this slide. Always comes back to this, internal and external motivation. We only procrastinate when we look to other people, places, or things. Look at the picture there. This is motivation. This is your energy. This is your power source. Anytime you're doing something for you, by you, you're invincible. So think of it as your superpower, kryptonite. So think about a coin. Both sides. One is a superpower, one is a kryptonite. The coin is your drive. When you're being internal, boom, superpower, change the world. When you're being externally motivated, you're looking to other people, kryptonite. It's horrible. Like, we stop. Any other questions, thoughts? Jeff? Okay. Good question. I'm going to repeat that for those playing on at home. When you're internally motivated, but yet you're still trying to help other people, how do you balance that staying internal versus losing yourself in the process? Okay. And so Jeff is a director validator. So his superpower is validation. So if he allows himself to be external in that validation, he will lose himself, exhaust himself, burn himself out, and then not have the lifestyle as a director that he wants, correct? Okay. So way that happens, and here's the best way to find out whether you're being internal or external, simply ask yourself, how do I feel? Your emotions are produced by you every single day. No one makes you feel an emotion. You do it. So let me pull this up. If we are being externally motivated, we feel the fear, the anxiety, the ego, the depression, the loneliness, the doubt, the pride, the scarcity. The second you feel that emotion, it's because your drive was being met through somebody else or wasn't being met through somebody else. So you put it on them to do it. I always love the analogy of the airplane, turbulence happens, oxygen mask falls from the ceiling. The rule is, like literally the government policy and rule is, put it on yourself first. Why? So you can help somebody else. A drowning man can never save another drowning man. So I was teaching this principle 15 years ago to a guy, and he said the most profound thing. He said, oh, I get it, Woody. It's the difference between being self-aware and selfish. If you're being external or you're looking to other people, then that's selfish. Even though they think, oh, I'm doing it for everybody else, I'm giving my time for them, still selfish. If you're doing it internally, it produces these emotions: hope, confidence, strength, faith, courage, vision, clarity, and charity. those emotions are produced for you every single time. That's your superpower. You get your drive met. So if you feel tired, if you feel exhausted, you are not protecting yourself. Take a moment, pause, do things for you, by you. Step away from everybody, put up some boundaries just for a day or two. Go out and play, do all the things we talked about earlier with the mindset. You will feel liberated instantly. Like just instantly, now, go out and do what you need to do in the world. Ooh, I love guilt. Let's go down that rabbit hole. I love guilt. Oh, guilt's a nasty little beast. Give me a second. Oh, I got a good one on guilt. Give me a second. I know. All the should has. I should. Quit shooting on yourself. Yep. Okay, so this. Yeah, I'll take care of myself after I'm dead. Yeah. After I've given myself. Okay. So I did some research on guilt. Oh, sorry, that's not showing up. So here's what I did. If you look up the definition of guilt in the dictionary, it actually only says awareness. We as a society, because of TV shows, have made guilt a negative thing. In a court of law, if you were found guilty, all that means is the court is aware of what you've done. But we put guilt as a negative connotation. So we end up either humiliating ourselves or inspiring ourselves. So remove the word guilt with awareness. If you feel guilty, all of a sudden you're feeling a little bit of awareness that something's off in your life. So are you going to traditionally humiliate yourself, beat yourself up, tear yourself down, or can it inspire you and say, you know what? I don't like this. I'm going to change it. Here's what was profound that I figured out is the distance from where you think you should be to where you think you are is the depth of the guilt you feel. So let's say you're 16 years old. You get your license. Driving home, blow through a stop sign, you get a speeding ticket. You feel about this much guilt. You know, mom and dad are going to be angry, they're going to take away the car, might lose, you know, car insurance, get grounded. Same thing happens 2 years later. Blow through the exact same stop sign, you hit a dog or a child. Where you feel you should be to where you are, that amount of guilt is where we feel just pain. We're the ones who make up this equation. We're the ones who, on our beliefs, not truth, on our beliefs, we think, oh, I should have been doing this. I should have been doing that. It's not true. You're not supposed to do that. You might have committed to it, but you have the right to change your mind. So guilt only comes from judging where we are to where we think we should be. If any of you guys have something guilt you want to talk about, I would love to actually take someone, break it down through your drive completely. So does anyone have something they feel guilty about or just pressure they feel? And then let's break it down through a drive. Man, I get so excited. I see a hand move. I'm like going for it. All right, let's go, Jeff. Yep. Sure. Sure. Yes, the should be's. Yes. 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 Okay, I love it. Okay, so those playing along at home, Jeff and his wife Allie moved here from Minneapolis and they didn't go home for for Christmas, and they've got multiple grandparents and multiple kids, and everyone thinks they should have been there. So your drive is director validator. This is your gas. So do you feel guilty because you're not giving them the recognition, or they're not giving you the recognition, and then accepted praise, trust, respect, validated, and being needed. Yeah. So guilt comes from our secondary drive. So I am a director executive. My guilt that I feel comes when I'm not winning, I'm not in control, I'm not working, reaching my goals, providing security, solving problems. That's where the guilt comes, because that means I'm not getting my car to move to where I want to be. So your guilt is tied 100% to your secondary drive. Little breakthrough, that's some cool breakthroughs right there, right? You know the funny thing is, that's the first time I've ever said that out loud. Like, it just kind of came to me, like, that's actually accurate. Like, in my head, I'm like, testing against everything I know. I'm like, yep, that's right, that's right. Yeah, yeah, that's cool. That's why I like these, I love the Q&A. So, yes, yeah. So here's how you solve that. Okay, so here's how you remove guilt based on your secondary drive. So if your secondary drive, keyword secondary drive, is director, do something that makes you feel free and independent. Pursue your life's purpose. Experience and create something new. That will remove the guilt. Simply by fueling up your tank, acknowledging what it is, moving forward. If your secondary is relator, treat yourself. If you guys ever seen, what is it called? Parks and Recreation. Oh, treat yourself. And they got a whole treat yourself. I love that episode. Reach out to your community. Forgive yourself or anyone who has caused you pain. That validation fuels the tank. Seek advice from others. Organize based on priority. Break the problem down to smaller parts. Validators, list your strengths. Seek advice from trusted sources. Reflect on the positive impact of others you've already had. Executives, research, gather proof, set small obtainable goals, let go of what you can't control. So for example, the one that I feel guilty that I haven't done for 3 years, I set very small obtainable goals. I owe Pierce $250 if I don't do it by Sunday. That's 78 hours, 76 hours, 72 hours. You know, let go and figure out what you can control. I've shared this quote before because it's one of my, I think it's one of the most important quotes that everyone should have on their bedroom wall or their kitchen wall. It's Phil Knight at Nike has a quote that says, I reserve the right to change my mind at any time. Some bizarre reason, we think if we say one thing to one person, that's law. Like, that's truth that we have to do that thing no matter what. No. That's just what I said I was going to do that time. I can wake up and say, you know what? That no longer meets my schedule. That no longer meets my needs. I no longer can fit that in my bandwidth. I love you. Can't do it. Boom. I'll just do something different. The key to it, though, is just communicating it to people. If you communicate to them, they are happy as can be. Any other thoughts, questions? Let's go with one more. Yes. Yep. Let's play with that one. Okay, we'll end on this. It's 8:15. All right, so. Your drive is created by drama and trauma. I have defined drama as dramatically positive. So seeing your child for the first time, graduating high school, that first kiss, that first love, that's a very positive, very dramatic experience. Trauma, we already know that's the negative. Something happens to you, bankruptcy, foreclosure, challenge, divorce, whatever it is, that's a trauma. So, and this is a fun exercise. For those of you at home, you guys here, do this as homework for fun. Go home, you've identified your drive, ask yourself, what was my earliest memory of a dramatic or traumatic experience that caused me to feel important to get this met? I'll give you mine. So when I was in the first grade, my first grade teacher told me I was stupid and I couldn't read. That created this desire to feel free and independent. It fueled my creativity, because since I couldn't read, I have an adult telling me that, then I can create. There's no such thing as rules for creativity. So that's where this desire to feel important came from. Now, during COVID, we had sold everything to go travel the world. So we sold the house, the cars, and everything. In 2019, January 1, 2020, we leave. We go to Florida. We hit all the Caribbean islands. April 1, we're supposed to hit Europe. March 27th, COVID hits. We're trapped. But we're homeless on, like, 3 days. Like, okay, we got to find a new house because they were kicking us out. So for a 7 month or for 18 month period, we lived in 7 houses because it was just Airbnb after Airbnb waiting. Okay, we'll go to Europe. We'll go to Europe. And we couldn't. We came here. During that time, my drive actually changed twice. And I had the same drive for 17 years because I always track it. No longer did I want lifestyle. My primary became executive. I wanted control because I did not feel I was in control. Liquidated everything, had the money, could go anywhere in the world I wanted to, but I can't leave this house. Horrible for me, like super traumatic. So I became an executive director. We then moved to Utah, got our feet grounded. We know people here. I started feeling grounded again. Went back through the drive because I could feel a change in me. I said, okay, what's my drive today? And I realized I was actually director, still wanted lifestyle, and I was executive for my gas. So, and I've done this a lot since COVID. I've asked people, how many of you guys feel different than you did 2 years ago? And usually it's like 70% of the room. Your drive changed during COVID. The reason why, oh, this is a really cool thing. I can tell you exactly why we have the mental health issue we have right now. When your drive changes, you don't know how to get met. A new drive is like a baby. It's learning to walk for the first time. So everything that you do is based off what's called your associations, how you see the world. Well, now I have a new association. I don't have any connection to it yet, but this is what makes me feel important. I don't have any habits of winning. I don't have any subconscious ideas of control, but I desire it now. So what happens, it takes 3-6 months learning new associations and letting go of the old ones because you've done them for so many years. So what happens is if you ever have change, significant change, moving, divorce, bankruptcy, foreclosure, a company change, any massive change, the fastest way to mentally get healthy is create as many new associations as you can. New hobby, new restaurants, new music. Pierce taught me this when we were in moving, because every 3 months we're in a new house. He said, this year I want a new smell. I'm like, huh? He goes, yeah, I read about this, that you should have an identity to a smell. So he threw away all his colognes and he got a new cologne. I thought, oh, I'm going to try that. And then when we have a significant move, I would create a new playlist. So now I have multiple playlists. I have a book writing playlist. I have a working playlist. So what it does is it changes my brain to adjust to the environment. Yeah. Yes. I know what you mean. But, sure. That makes 100%. This is the car. This is the destination you want. When these aren't getting met, the car's on empty on the side of the road. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll show you another one. This, I want to make sure I'm right. So go back. You're a later director, correct?
But I really care about.
Yes. So I'm going to show you that. What? Oh, hey, Lainey, how are you? We sit down, is my fly down? My intellect's going to show? I've never heard a reference to that, but all right. I was nervous. I got nervous of that one. Literal actual, got it. Okay. Context is everything. I have learned in my life. Context is everything. Okay. Yes. So it's an upside down T. You have what makes you feel important. You have what is your secondary. These bottom ones rotate based off the environment and the situation that you're in. So I am a director executive, but Drive is totally intellectual. Like, the whole system of Drive is geniusly intellectual, but it doesn't make me feel important. I still use this bottom to help me get these met, but it's not what makes me feel important. So if you're flipped, so you're relator director, but you're still tapping into winning control to fuel yourself. You're still tapping into validation. You're still tapping into systems. But the key is what makes you feel important, because that's what triggers your emotions. That's what triggers your mindset, your beliefs, your conviction. All that stems from what makes you feel important. The bottom ones rotate solely based off of the environment situation. Lainey. Oh, on the Drive, it's the very last one. Yep. Gotcha. And that's why I always say, which cards has the most amount of words? If I said, pick one card on here that's the most important to you, that's a different equation. And so you might say, winning is absolutely the most important to me, but that doesn't make you feel important. And we only make decisions based off what makes us feel important. We buy based off emotion. We get into relationships based off emotion. Everything's emotion driven. But love that clear look. Any last thoughts, questions before we wrap up? Yes, Susan. Go ahead, sister. I got some Kleenexes for you. Try every time, please. Let it. We're family. Let it out. That's it. Yeah. We're all a hot mess. Let it go. Yeah.
I am definitely a hot mess right now.
I love that. Notice I have tissues in my bag for this whole reason. I cry all the time, so please let it go. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Thank you for taking one for the team. I appreciate that.
You're welcome. Anybody else, I probably would still.
Let it out. Let's go. Yeah. Sure. Okay, so I'm gonna pause you there, and I want to break it down, because this applies to everybody. This is one thing I love about human behavior. Is if one person is experiencing it, it's a real thing, means we're all at some point in our life going to experience it. Okay, so your primary is relator, secondary is director? Okay, and so for those, again, watching at home, she is in education, but you also do dance, and you got kicked off of your dance group. So this goes exactly to what I was saying about your associations, the way we connect our identity to everybody else, is through associations. They got ripped from you. That's the same thing as a divorce, a bankruptcy, a foreclosure. So anytime our drive is tied to an association, which is normal, that's totally normal, but the second gets ripped, the fastest way to mentally and emotionally get healthy is get new associations. And that's called a reassociation. You relabel what's happening to you. You give it a different meaning. Your identity is not that dance. You have used the dance to get your drive met. But how long ago did you start the dance? Okay, but during different club, different group, right?
For fun, yeah.
Yeah, so this exact team that you got removed from, how long ago? No, but how long ago, when did you start with them? Okay, so if I go back 7 years ago, you didn't even know about them. That drive was still getting met because you had different associations. Yeah, but you hadn't built an association to it yet. You knew of them, but emotionally, they weren't making you feel important. Yeah, but it didn't lift you and build you and fill you up. Dancing, I'm talking about the group, because you can still dance, right? So whether they allow you on or off, you can still dance. So what happened is you made the group make you feel important, not dance make you feel important. And that happens to all of us. The second we tie our identity to a physical thing, a person, place, a thing, and that thing now removes us, or we are removed from it, then we crash emotionally. Or we remove ourselves. Yeah. There's here's a fun slide. And thank you for your vulnerability. Okay, how many have seen this picture before? The old woman, the young woman. Okay? Can everyone see the old woman and the young woman in this picture? And if you can't, let me know and I'll show you which ones are where. Okay? The picture is the same. What are you looking at? The young woman or the old woman? They're all there. Life is neutral, totally neutral. We put the value on it based on our belief. So in this scenario, it's okay, what is the truth? The truth is you can still dance, correct? The truth is there's more than those 6 people, 10 people, 12 people had danced with. And so what I do for myself is I start asking, what's the truth? What's the truth? What's the truth? Because the belief is all this monster pain, but the truth is like 4 things. And the second you lean into that truth, you're liberated. Just you're instantly liberated. It's the same analogy of the captain in the battleship and the lighthouse. The second you see the truth, you're in safe harbor. But that captain, that battleship, he's getting madder and angry, and he's like, I'm a battleship, I'm a this, I'm a that. No, that's a belief. The truth is this. It's a beautiful thing. Did you want to go any deeper than that? Is there anything else? I just want to make sure. It's the pit. Oh, you're gonna. Hell yeah, you're gonna. We all are gonna. Like, that's a normal. Okay. Okay, this is the thing I love about drive. It's never going to make you not have a bad day. What it does for you is you get to decide how long that day stays bad. That's the thing I love about drive. Things happen to us. Horrible things happen to everybody all the time. Cars get broken into, bankruptcies, COVID, foreclosures, those things happen. But you now knowing your drive, and you go to what's the truth, you get to decide how long you suffer. No. It definitely, based off this scenario, I know it hasn't, because what did change was how you got it met. You used to go to the dance, you used to have a relationship, you used to have a group, a safety, a community. So back to your drive, your community was ripped from you, right? As a relator, you want community. That's your number one drive. It got ripped from you. So what you had to do is create a community with yourself first, that's the internal, then create a new external community. And one of my favorite quotes, behavior will not change until the reassociation. You will feel this much pain until you create a reassociation. Yeah, and we all need to. So whenever I get stuck, the first question I ask myself is, what reassociation do I need? So if I'm beating myself up, I'm tearing myself down, I'm just going through the routine like we always do, what reassociation do I need right now? When I coach people, same thing. What reassociation would change your behavior like that? What's that? The other analogy, you hear a thud in the middle of the night. I don't care if you're a grown man or a grown woman, you are scared to death. Is there an intruder coming in? You muster up, you get out of bed, and you look out the window, and you see a dog going through your garbage can. Instantly, your brain reassociates what the noise was. You go back to sleep, like it's no big deal. You look out the window and you see shards of glass on your patio, now you're losing your mind. Because you have truth. You have truth to what the noise was. So for all of us, ask yourself, what is the truth and what reassociation do I need? And that, those two questions will solve almost 80 to 90% of all human behavior. I mean, just those two questions alone, then back it up with clarity and conviction, and at that point, you're home free. So from the bottom of my heart, you guys, we've done this every day since, what, or every week since March. It's been a blast. This is our last one live here in Utah. I go to Europe for the summer. I am going to find out a way to somehow do them there, broadcast them, do them online. I have a Facebook group that I'm going to start to reactivate. I haven't used it in a couple years, but it's called Drive Sales System. So it's easy to remember. It's the name of the book, Drive Sales System. Go on to Facebook, connect there. Follow me on Facebook because I will start posting Thursdays in Europe. And what's going to be fun is I'm going to have tons of new stories because I'm going to live until I die. So I'm just going to go out and do stupid stuff, which will bring us new stories. So there's going to be a lot of dumb things I'm going to do this summer. I'm doing running the bulls. I went to the doctor today, got a cortisone shot in my knee just to make sure I could do running the bulls. So yeah, there's going to be some fun stuff. I'm not, like I said, there's no common sense. Don't judge me. There's no common sense. But from the bottom of my heart, you guys, I love you. Thank you so much for playing with me these last 3-4 months. And let's just keep doing it online. And then when I come back in August and September, we'll do them again. So thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you, guys. Appreciate ya. Appreciate ya. And then we'll clear out of here. We'll go in the hallway and we can sit and mash by and talk as long as anyone wants. Thank you guys all very, very much.